Well, good morning, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers here in the room. We are so excited to have you here to worship with us this morning. And just to add a little note, I'm sure Pastor Stephen will mention, but to all the men here in the room, you'll want to make sure to stick around to the very end, and on the way out, there will be a nice little gift for you. So that's just a little teaser not to leave too early. So if you're visiting with us this morning, you'll find in the pew in front of you, there's a little welcome card in the pew. If you wouldn't mind taking a moment and just filling that out, and as you leave this morning, if you wouldn't mind dropping it in one of the offering boxes, we'd love to have a record of you being here with us this morning. And as always, it's a way that you can communicate if you want to learn what's going on here at the church, if you want to speak to one of the pastors, staff members. If you have a prayer request, that's another way that you can also submit those as well. They get turned in to Pastor Stephen or myself, and it's just a way for us to get to know you and to know that you are here with us this morning. Our scripture reading comes from Psalms 117 this morning, and it's just two short verses. It says, "Praise the Lord, all nations, extol him, all peoples, for great is his steadfast love towards us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord." Will you pray with me this morning? God, we do just give you thanks as we come here this morning on this Father's Day, as we think about and remember all the men that you've placed in our lives, whether it's our fathers, our grandparents, just men who have encouraged us, who have poured into us, who have been there for us. Lord, we give you thanks this morning, and I pray that we would take time today to make sure that we say thank you to those men who have been an influence in our lives, Lord. And we just thank you for your influence in our lives. And I pray that that is the reason that we are here this morning, that we would just draw close to you, Lord, that you would just be speaking to us here this morning, that you would just be preparing us to hear your word and the challenge from Pastor Stephen this morning in preparation for us to head out and to be your hands and your feet in this community which you've placed us in. And we got to see glimpses of that this last week, and we pray and give thanks for the children and the family that we got to meet and be a part of their lives this last week at Vacation Bible School, Lord. And we just continue to pray that you would just work in their hearts, and if you lead them to our church or a church, Lord, that we can rejoice and celebrate in that. And we just thank you, and we want to give you all the praise and glory as we worship here this morning together, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Troy?
This morning, let's start off with hymn 445, "Yes, Lord, Yes."
I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. Where your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
And then 264, "Worthy is the Lamb."
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the wash me in your cleansing flow. now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne, crowned you now with many crowns, you reign victorious. Jesus, Son of God, the treasure of heaven crucified, worthy is the Lamb. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy crown you now with many crowns, you reign victorious. I am lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the treasure of heaven crucified. Worthy is the Lamb.
His eye is on the sparrow.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Let not your heart troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on His goodness, I lose my doubt and fears. Though by the path He leadeth, but one step I may see, His and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on me. Whenever I am tempted whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to Him. From care He sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me.
This morning, Miss Christie has a special.
Well, that was the song I was going to sing. But guess what? I don't have the breath for that one, so we're going to sing another one.
Finding more come together today, we want to take the opportunity just to remember Father's Day and to kind of honor and celebrate our fathers here this morning. I am blessed this morning. This week, I was just recently reading an article that said that Father's Day is one of the lowest attended Sundays out of the year. Now, the interesting part about that is in comparison to Mother's Day, which is usually about the second or third highest attended Sunday of a year. And so I'm blessed this morning because as I look out here across this crowd to see the crowd that is gathered here together today, I think what a wonderful way to honor our fathers and for our fathers to help to lead us there into spiritual things. And so I'm blessed to see here on Father's Day today that you have come out together to worship the Lord together today. What a blessing that is today. And so if you are a father let's just take the opportunity to, I'd say we'll just do it this way. We'll just give a round of applause and just take the opportunity just to thank our fathers there this morning. And so if you're a father, I want to ask just our fathers just to go ahead and stand up here a moment this morning. And we'll just take the opportunity just to say thank you to them for what they've done and just to give them a round of applause here this morning. Thank you very much. I'll let you guys go ahead and we have a small gift. You guys go ahead and have your seat. We have a small gift for all of our men here in honor of our Father's Day today. So before you leave, make sure you do that. I think what a blessing it is if you have a father who's been involved and blessed in your life, what a blessing that is. I think one of the greatest influences that we have both to lead us in our faith and to make a positive impact in our life is there are fathers who are involved. And if you have that, you realize what a blessing that is. And I know that sometimes when we speak to a crowd like this, there are many here that have not experienced that. Either their fathers have not been involved or maybe their fathers have passed away. And so as we look at that, what we always remember is this, is we often judge God by our fathers. And I think the encouragement that we need to have is this, is that as we do that, we need to remember that God is the example for us as fathers. We don't judge God by the role of our father. All of our fathers, even the best of our fathers, are fallen beings. But we're grateful for those who have been involved, who have showed up, who have guided and directed, and we're grateful for those that have made a difference in others' lives. And so thank you to our fathers there this morning. You serve an important role there today. If you have your Bibles this morning, we are heading to Acts chapter 17. If you've ever traveled internationally, you know and understand the importance of oftentimes cultural differences. To be aware that just because we do one thing one way here in the United States doesn't mean that every culture does it that way. And so oftentimes you want to be aware of that as you travel. I think that just a simple thing there is in Australia when you're dining, don't ask for a napkin. And that's just a little thing. If that little piece of paper that you wipe your hands on is a serviette, right? A napkin is what you put on a baby's behind to keep them from making a mess everywhere else. And so you typically don't want to wipe your hands on that. So just small, simple things like that often make us aware that even in similar cultures, there's some cultural differences. And if you travel those cultures, you want to be aware of those differences so that you don't intentionally or unintentionally offend the person that you're trying to be friends with. And so it's important as we look at it, we come to Acts chapter 17 today, we want to take the opportunity to look at this idea that as we share the gospel there, and hopefully as you're coming here to the book of Acts, you understand that that's part of our mission. We've been called to take the gospel to all the world. That as we share the gospel, that we often change our approach for our different audience. Now, I think it's important that we understand this, right? We do not change our message. The message is essentially the same, but the way that we approach or the way that we share the message will often change there on the audience that we're sharing the gospel with. Knowing that today we live in a multicultural, pluralistic society, we can no longer assume that every person that we're talking to understands or agrees the same basic principles that we believe. And so oftentimes as we begin some of these conversations, sometimes we've got to begin either at zero or below zero, building up to that foundation so that we have the opportunity to share the gospel and as we share the gospel, people comprehend and understand what we're saying. We come to Acts chapter 17. We're going to break this chapter up into two parts. The Apostle Paul and Silas are still continuing their second missionary journey. They come to two new towns. The first town they come to is the town of Thessalonica. This is, if you in your New Testament, you find the book of 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians that was written to this church here in this town of Thessalonica. They had the opportunity to share the gospel there. We'll look at what they did there. That went by quickly. They had to leave, and they go to another place called Berea. We'll look at both of those, share some similar characteristics of how they shared the gospel. And so with that, they're verses 1 through 15, we'll start that first part there together. And they had passed around, see, even I can't even get some of these words, right? So as you read some of these words, understand that it's difficult. Amphilus and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica to where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul's, his custom was, went into them for their three Sabbaths, reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and demonstrating that Christ had to suffer to rise again from the dead, saying, "This is Jesus whom I preach to you is the Christ." And some of them were persuaded, and a great multitude of the devout Greeks, and not a few of the leading women joined Paul and Silas. But the Jews who were not persuaded became envious, took some of the evil men from the marketplace, gathering a mob, set all of the city into an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them out to the people. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brethren to the rulers of the city, crying out, "These men have turned the whole world upside down who have come here too. Jason has harbored them, and they are all acting contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus." And they troubled the crowd and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. And when they had taken security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. Then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. They were more fair-minded than those of Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness, searched the Scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Therefore, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women as well as men. And as when these Jews from Thessalonica heard that the word of the Lord was preached by Paul at Berea, they came there also, stirred up the crowds, and immediately the brethren sent Paul away to go to the sea. But both Silas and Timothy remained there. So those who conducted Paul brought him to Athens and received a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him with all speed. They departed. The first part we want to look at is where Paul shares the gospel both in Thessalonica and in Berea. We'll see that he used the same methods with different responses there together. So as I was looking at this, if you have your Bibles, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, you've probably heard this passage before here in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. It is often misused as an excuse for often kind of doing whatever we want to do, and because we're just trying to be culturally appropriate, or we're trying to, this kind of buzzword that we use, we're trying to be relevant. And so the idea is this, though, is we want to understand the differences in culture as we begin to share the gospel. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, starting there in verse 19, it's the Apostle Paul speaking of his ministry. Says this, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all that I might win the more. To the Jews, I became as a Jew that I might win the Jews. To those who were under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who were under the law. To those who are without the law, as without the law, not being without the law." And that's an important characteristic, right? He's saying to those who do not have the revelation of God, I shared the gospel in a different way, yet I didn't act as if I didn't have the law. Not without being the law towards God, but under the law towards Christ, that I might win those who are without the law. To the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I've become all things to all men, that I might all means save some. He's not talking about being a chameleon and compromising to reach this crowd and then compromising to reach this crowd. What he's talking about is we adjust our cultural approach to reach a different person. We see this illustrated, I believe, here in Acts chapter 17. So what am I saying? When we begin to share the gospel with a religious person, how do we do it differently? When you share the gospel with a religious person, what we see is this, is we begin with some of the common ground. We know The Apostle Paul's method as he began to share the gospel is that he would go to the Jews first. He would go to the synagogue and he would share the gospel in the synagogue there with the Jews first. And then when they would reject the message, he would go out into the marketplace and to share it then with the Gentiles. And that's exactly what he does right here in verse 17. In verse 1, you'll notice, I just thought I'd make this, by the way, a comment there. Verse 1, we see the Ignatian Way, one of the main roads, or thoroughfares, highways running throughout the Roman Empire. And you see Paul traveling the Ignatian Way. And Philius, Apollonia, Thessalonica were all stops there on that road. That would be like I-80 today or I-70 here in the United States would be the Ignatian Way. And he's traveling here across the Ignatian Way. And it says that when he came to Thessalonica, there was a synagogue of the Jew. And as his custom was, he went into them and for three Sabbaths reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and demonstrating that Christ had to suffer to rise from the dead, saying, "This Jesus to whom I preach to you is the Christ." And so what do we see? When we begin with the person who has a religious background, and I think as we share the gospel here in Bedford, one of the things that we have, one of the privileges that we have, is that we often have people that have church backgrounds. They may have grown up in Sunday school. They may have had some religious instruction back in school. They may have had some type of religious upbringing. And now, typically, when we share the gospel with them, there's some common ground that we have that we can often begin with there. What are some of the common grounds that we have? When the Apostle Paul shared the gospel with the Jews, there were some basic assumptions that he could make when he would go into the synagogue. His custom was he would go into the synagogue as long as they would have him for three Sabbaths. He reasoned with them from the Scriptures. They opened up the Old Testament. He showed them from the Old Testament who Jesus Christ was, his sacrifice there for sin, his resurrection from the dead, and he tried to persuade them that just Jesus is the Messiah that you've been waiting for. One of the common assumptions that we have is this, right, when we talk to religious people, is the common assumption of the Scripture. We can say to them, well, if you open up your Bible, this is what the Bible says. There's that common assumption. People who are typically religious in our area assume that the Bible is the Word of God. And so we can begin to kind of take them back to the Bible. Secondly, they have the common hope in the Messiah. These Jews have been waiting for and longing for the Messiah to come. And so the Apostle Paul, part of his evangelism, would say, this Jesus is the Messiah that you have been waiting for. When we share the gospel today, we talk about a kind of a common belief in who Jesus is. There's some common things that we believe about Jesus that we don't have to kind of lay that foundation again to move forward. And then there's some common understanding of doctrinal issues, right? We talk about this issue of sin. If you talk to a religious person, they would understand that sin is falling short of God's righteous demands. They would understand that sin demands judgment or discipline, that God, being holy and righteous, cannot tolerate sin, and so he must judge sin. They would understand that salvation then is to be saved from that judgment that is to come. And then they would also understand then the idea that sacrifice is necessary. Now, what they understand about some of those things, we may not always agree, but there's some basic understanding that we have about some of those things, right? When the Apostle Paul spoke with the Jews, they knew all of these things. They may not have been sacrificing now because the temple was, they weren't near to the temple, but they would understand what the purpose of the sacrifice was. So when we have some of those common grounds, we can share some of those things. What is important for us, both when we share the gospel with religious and non-religious people, is we do not back away from what is not popular just to gain converts. You see, the Apostle Paul didn't back away from what was not popular. What was not popular was this, is the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. They were longing for a Messiah who would be a political Messiah, who would come and overthrow Rome, and who would build up the nation of Israel and reestablish the Jewish kingdom. That's what they were longing for. And all of a sudden, you're telling me that this Messiah not only had to suffer, but this Messiah died, and he was buried, and he rose again. There were certainly a lot of the Jews who didn't believe in the resurrection from the dead. We don't back away from things that are not popular just to gain converts. We have to be careful with this. Oftentimes, in the name of relevance, we compromise the harder points of the gospel message. We de-emphasize sin and judgment. We de-emphasize holiness and the need for holiness. And we want to be liked, and that desire to be liked is nothing new. So we see this warning. We have to be careful not to compromise the gospel message just to be liked. But what we also see is this, right, is we need to be faithful to share the gospel. That's right. The response of the gospel is up to Jesus Christ. The response belongs to God. And so as we look there at that response, we see the response belongs to him. What happens in Thessalonica? In Thessalonica, there are certain who begin to believe. There are certain Jews who began to believe. There were some of the proselytes or the faithful Greeks who began to believe, and leading and prominent women. And it's interesting, they tolerate Paul teaching about Christ until he begins to see success in people believing and receiving Jesus Christ as Savior, particularly some of the Greeks or the Gentiles. When some of the Gentiles began to believe, all of a sudden, they want to shut them down. And so there are some leaders there in the synagogue who, becoming envious of Paul, seek to shut him down. And so what they do is they go into downtown, there to the square, the city square, where the worthless men, the guys who kind of just hang out at the corner, the rabble-rousers, the troublemakers, and they either are able to bribe these guys or persuade these guys, but they stir these guys up who are able to incite a mob, and they then go and try to take Paul and Silas and drag them before the magistrates. So they go to where Paul and Silas are staying at Jason's house. They think they're going to get Paul and Silas, but apparently Paul and Silas weren't there. Either they heard ahead of time and some of the brethren hid Paul and Silas, or Paul and Silas may have been out preaching in the square or something and or doing some other ministry, and they're not there. So they can't get Paul and Silas, but they get Jason and some of the other Christians that are there with him, and they drag them in front of the magistrates, and they say, these men are turning the world upside down, and Jason's harboring them, and we need to do something about it. And so finally the magistrates say, okay, well, they take a security, a bond from Jason. We don't know what that is. Perhaps it was a financial, you know, like a bond that we would have today. Perhaps it was just a promise to say, we'll send Paul and Silas on their way. But they take that from Jason. So we have the group in Thessalonica, by and large, reject the gospel. Yes, there's the foundation, the starting church, and that church remains. But the majority reject the gospel and turn away from it. They leave Thessalonica. They come to Berea. They do the same exact thing. Notice that's one of the things I appreciate of Paul. It doesn't change his approach. This has gotten him in trouble in many different cities before, right? Where he's gone to the synagogue. He's preached Jesus Christ to the synagogue. The Jews have gotten angry and upset. They've persecuted him and ran him out of town. And what does he do? He goes to the next town. He goes straight to the synagogue and preaches Jesus Christ to the Jews again. So he comes into Berea, and he preaches the gospel in the synagogue again. They invite him into the synagogue. He says, this Jesus whom I preach is the Messiah that you've been waiting for. And notice the response is different in Berea. Matter of fact, you may have noticed that. Perhaps you've heard of a church that's called Berean. Like, this is the Berean church. You know why? Why are they the Berean church? Particularly if they're not in a town or a city that's called Berea. Why do they want to be known as the Bereans? Well, because of what it says here, right? And it goes on to say there, verse 11, that these were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scripture daily to find out whether these things were so. We see the response of the Bereans was this, as they heard Paul preach and say, here's what the Old Testament says, and Jesus Christ fulfills these prophecies, and this is a long way to Messiah. And they said, Paul, that's really interesting. What were the scripture references again? Can you write those down for us? Because we want to go back and we want to study that. They didn't just accept it at face value as to say, well, the preacher said it. You know, when we look at this, is to say, what are some bad reasons to believe what you believe? And here's some bad reasons to believe what you believe, because that's what my church believes. Why do you believe that? Well, my church believes that, so I believe that. It's a bad reason to believe what you believe because that's what my mom and dad believe. Like that was the way that I was brought up, and my mom and dad believe this, and so I believe this. That's a bad reason to believe what you believe. It's a bad reason to believe it because, well, that's what everybody else is doing. Or that's what my denomination believes. What is a good reason to believe what you believe? A good reason to believe what you believe is because this is what the Bible says so. And the Bereans, they weren't satisfied as just to say, well, the leaders of our synagogue have said this, and so we therefore believe what the leaders have said. And they weren't satisfied enough to say, well, Paul, what you're saying sounds pretty convincing and pretty interesting. I think we're going to believe what you say. What do they say? They say, Paul, what you said sounds pretty persuasive. Before we believe that, let's study and search the Scriptures. And notice what it said. They searched the Scriptures daily to see whether these things were so or not. And as they searched the Scriptures, what were they convinced of? They were convinced that Jesus was the Messiah that they were waiting for, and they put their faith and trust in Him. This is why oftentimes we want to be known as Berean Christians. We want to be those who study the Word of God and believe the Word of God. What's the difference between the people in Thessalonica and the people in Berea? Well, obviously, other than the major difference between they study the Word of God and they believe the Word of God, there's no external difference. There wasn't a difference in Paul's approach that, like this, you know, if you do this formula over here in Berea, it's really good. But what you did, the formula that you used here in Thessalonica, no, Paul did the same thing in both places. The response belongs to God. I think that's important for us as we share the gospel. Oftentimes we say, well, you know, I share the gospel, I didn't see a response. Well, that's okay. Your responsibility wasn't to make them believe. Your responsibility was just to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The believing part belongs to God. The Holy Spirit will do the convicting and the convincing as long as you're faithful to share. Brings us here to the second point. One of the tragedies that we see today, the fastest growing category in the world of religion is that of nuns. Okay, and we're not talking of the Catholic ladies who wear the hat, I mean the robes and the hats. What we're talking about is when you say, what do you believe? And they would say, none. I have no belief. I don't believe in anything. It's different from atheists and agnostic. Atheists and agnostics believe that there is no God, or that they don't care to know. Nuns just say, I don't know, and I don't really care to know. Like, they might be in the spiritual but not religious category, right? I want to be spiritual but not religious. I like a little bit of Oprah over here and a little bit of the Dalai Lama over here. And the, you know, the Pope's got some interesting things, and I put a couple quotes on my Facebook page that were interesting. Tragically, one of the things that we've noticed just recently, right, if you're paying attention in church life, is I believe it was Barna that just did the research as to notice that we've reached that point where 47% of the American population identify with the local church or any form of church. That doesn't mean that they attend church. That just means that they, the big news of that is for the first time in a long time, the United States is not a majority Christian nation. There's no, or at least they do not identify as a majority Christian nation. And we do understand that there's a large gap between those who identify with going to church and those who truly trusted Jesus Christ as Savior. There's a large gap between that. But what that reveals to us is this idea of the non-religious person is growing. You know, 40, 50 years ago, it may have been unpopular. It probably was not uncommon, but it wouldn't have been the popular thing to do. If you wanted to be widely accepted, if you wanted to be seen as a fine, moral, upstanding person within the community, you would have attended church at least once a week. It may have been any church. You wanted to go to church because there was a cultural pressure to attend church. You know, today there's no cultural pressure to attend church. Matter of fact, what we're seeing is just the opposite, right? It's countercultural to attend church on a weekend service. And tragically, even amongst Christians, it's countercultural to attend church every week. Oftentimes, a faithful Christian is one who's looked at going to church two or three times a month. And so we're seeing a shift and a change. So this increasing category of those who are non-religious, which means this, when we come to share the gospel with them, right, we cannot assume they understand when we talk about terms like sin, about revelation, when we talk about judgment. We can't understand that they agree with us. So how do we share the gospel with a non-religious person? And it's interesting because in Acts chapter 17, the Apostle Paul comes to Athens. Athens is the cultural center of the world, right? Rome is the political center. Athens is a cultural center. It used to be that Athens was both the cultural and the political center of the world, but as Rome kind of began to rise, Athens became the intellectual and cultural center. Matter of fact, when you look at Athens today, you're amazed still, like all of our math today, a lot of that originated out of Greece, out of Athens. Much of what we know today, particularly about Western culture is influenced by what took place here in Athens. Athens was influential. Rome, even as they conquered the world, let Athens be a free city because of the influence that Athens had on the world. And so we come to this place. It would be, to us today, it's probably similar to a place like a London or a New York. You think kind of a cultural center, that the influence is felt throughout the world. And that's where Athens is. And so the Apostle Paul is sent by ship from there in Berea. He takes the ship down to Athens, and he begins to wander through the city of Athens. And that's where we pick up there in verse 16. And Paul waited for them in Athens. His spirit was provoked within him when he saw the city was given over to idols. Therefore, he reasoned with the synagogue of the Jews and with the Gentile worshipers in the marketplace, daily with those who happened to be there. Then certain Epicureans and Stoic philosophers encountered him and said, "What does this babbler want to say?" And others said, "Well, he seems to be a proclaimer of foreign gods, because he preached to them Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, and saying, "May we know what this new doctrine is of which you speak? For you seem are bringing some strange things to our ears. Therefore, we want to know these things, what they mean." And all the Athenians and foreigners who were there spent their time in nothing else but to either to tell or to hear something new. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. And as I was passing through and considering the object of your worship, I found an altar to this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Therefore, the one to whom you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples with men's hands. Nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives life to all life and breath and all things, and is made from one blood every nation on men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-apportioned times, the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope to him and find him, for though he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and we have our being. Also, your own poets have said, 'For we are his offspring.' Therefore, we ought not, or we are the offspring of God. We ought not to think of that divine nature as like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art or men's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained, and has given assurance to this day by all by raising him from the dead. And when they heard the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, others said, 'We will hear you again on this matter.' And so Paul departed from among them. However, some men joined him and believed. Among them were Dionysus, the Areopagite, and a woman by the name of Damaris, and others with them." What do we see? I think one of the first things that we need to ask ourselves as we talk about non-religious people, the question is this: do we grieve over those who are far away from God? The Apostle Paul came into the city of Athens, and he, you notice, he is by himself. Paul and Timothy, or Silas and Timothy, had remained back at Berea to help to shore up the foundation of the church there, to disciple them, to get them kind of moving off on the right feet. The brothers had brought Paul to Athens. They'd gone back now to Berea with the word that Silas and Timothy were to join them as soon as they were finished, and Paul is wandering around the city. And as he's wandering around the city, you'll notice that his spirit is provoked within him. He grieves. He's both angered and grieved. He's angered because these people here are following these worthless idols. He's grieved these people who are far away from God, who the way of salvation is available to them, and yet they're ignorant of him. Oftentimes, what do we do when we see people who are far away from God? We could do this at a pagan temple. You know, you don't have to go overseas to see a pagan temple. You can find a Buddhist temple here within Bloomington. You might do that at a college campus. You walk across a college campus and seeing a lot of young people there who are full of life and yet far away from God. Young people who are involved in sin and celebrating in sin, rejecting what God says is the right way. And oftentimes, what are we tempted to do? We're tempted to get angry and upset, and these people. And we think that if we go to our angry voice and to our angry place, we become shrill, that all of these people will respond and they'll turn from their sin and turn right back to God. How many times has that ever worked well for us, right? We're tempted to get angry. We may even be tempted to become a little bit frustrated. But how often do we grieve? How often do we look at these people who are far away from God, living a lifestyle that is their what God calls sin? Do we look at them and to say, man, God loves them. He's provided a way of salvation for them, and they don't know this God who loves them. Paul, when he saw this, grieved. He then would talk to everyone who would listen. And so he went to the synagogue. He began reasoning with the Jews who were there in the synagogue there in Athens. Later, he would go out into the marketplace, into the agora. And as he would go into the marketplace, he would just begin to preach and to share the gospel, whether it was a one-on-one conversations or whether that was just open-air preaching. He would share the gospel with anyone who would listen. And it's interesting because as he does this, he begins kind of this dialogue or this debate there with the Epicureans and the Stoics. The Epicureans, they believed that life was about living for pleasure, right? Life is short, just live it up, do what's pleasing to yourself. They were atheists, and their goal was to live for pleasure. We certainly understand that. We live in a world today where people often live for pleasure. The Stoics responded to that. They were pantheists. They believed that kind of the world was God. And so they believed that, life was short. You might as well it's about self-mastery. How do I kind of pull all things under control? How do I be detached from all things? We kind of think maybe of like Buddhists today who would do some of that. And so they were about self-mastery. How do I master myself? And Paul is reasoning both with the Stoics and the Epicureans. It's interesting to note, right? These are not really religions. These are philosophies. Those philosophies would have been evidence in all the religions. So when you come to Greece, to Athens, right, you had the Parthenon, where there's like 52 different gods celebrated within the Parthenon. The main goddess of Athens is Athena. The city is named after Athena, goddess of wisdom and beauty. They were part of their religions, the philosophies undergirding. It's helpful for us to understand the dangerous, I guess, nature of, we don't have to change religions, often be influenced by the world's philosophy. The world's philosophy can even infect Christianity. Christianity ought to be its own philosophy, its own way of thinking, but oftentimes we adapt the world's way of thinking and we kind of just mold it into Christianity. And so that's what Paul's doing. And so as he's sharing the gospel, there's some people that come in to say, what does this babbler say? And it's interesting because this word babbler here literally means seed picker, right? What is a seed picker? A seed picker was a bird that would go throughout the marketplace picking up crumbs and bits and pieces. And it was kind of a derogatory or a slang use of a person who would pick up bits and pieces of information without fully understanding or digesting the information that they were getting. Somebody who likes to sound smart, a sophomore in college, right? A sophomore in college literally means the wise fool, right? Somebody who's had enough education classes to think that they know what they're talking about. The more that they talk, the more they reveal they don't know what they're talking about. And so if you've been in that field for a while, you kind of just stand back and let them talk. And they're just regurgitating everything that they've heard in this class. And it sounds fantastic. They got all the right terms. They really aren't using them the right way, but they sound smart. And that's what they're saying about Paul. Paul here is a seed picker. Like, you pick a little bit of this religion, a little bit of this religion, and you don't understand what you're talking about. It's because they didn't understand this Jesus. They didn't know who he was talking about. They didn't understand the background. So they say to him, we want to know a little bit more about this Jesus and about this resurrection. Whether they understood that was a part of who Jesus was, or whether they thought that like it was a god and a goddess, we're not quite sure. But they invite him to the Areopagus. The Areopagus here is Mars Hill. Mars Hill, or the Areopagus, is the same thing. It was the council that was responsible for governing what the city of Athens believed. It was kind of a mixture of a town council, but it was also a kind of an intellectual, philosophical, religious council. And as you can see by the passage, that it was populated by people who loved nothing more than to gather and to hear something new. They wanted learning for the sake of learning. They never were changed by what they learned. They just wanted to learn something new. This is interesting. Let's learn something new today. And so they would gather together, and they would often kind of pride themselves by how smart and wise and intelligent they were, because they were always about learning. Never about doing, always about learning. And this is what they do. So they invite Paul. They say, Paul, you've got some new religion we've never heard. Why don't you come here to the Areopagus? And this picture here that you see here is the Areopagus. It is set up right across the valley here from this is the remains of the Parthenon. Right? The Parthenon was there in the Acropolis in Athens. If you were to go to the Acropolis in Athens, on the Acropolis in Athens, you had some several different shrines. There was obviously the shrines to Athena, the goddess of Athens. But here was the Parthenon, that there was a multitude of gods that were represented there. And so Mars Hill sits over here. The Acropolis is over here, kind of right across the valley from each other. Paul is looking across there, seeing it's impressive. And at this time, this would have been a very impressive complex, very beautiful. Much of what we understand today about the beauty and comes here from this Greek ideal. And so Paul begins to share the gospel here in the Areopagus with these people who are through and through pagans. They do not understand who the God of the Old Testament is. They do not long for and have been waiting for a Messiah. They do not recognize the Scriptures. They probably don't even know the Scriptures. They may know who the Jews are, but they've probably never read their sacred texts. And so we'd understand this, right? They have little to no understanding of who God is. So how does Paul share the gospel with him? Well, you notice that he introduces them to a God they do not know. And I think there's some principles that we can see as we look and we study Paul's sermon. This is the third of Paul's sermons recorded, the last of the sermons recorded here in the book of Acts. One of the first principles we see is this, is look for cultural bridges. You'll notice that when the Apostle Paul comes to address this crowd, he doesn't say, you guys are out-and-out pagans who are worshiping these false idols. They're not even gods. Look, you're on your way to hell, and unless you repent and turn around, all of that's true, right? What does he do? He comes in there with a cultural bridge. I think it serves us to realize this. Don't insult the audience that you're trying to reach with the gospel. It may be true. We understand that. They don't know that yet, right? They've never been exposed to the gospel. Yes, they're out-and-out pagans. Yes, if they don't repent and put their faith in Jesus Christ, they are on their way to hell. But the Apostle Paul looks for a cultural bridge. And one of the things that he says is this. He says, I perceive that you are very spiritual, which is very true. They're in the darkness, but they're spiritually groping in the darkness. Matter of fact, they were so spiritual that they had altars all over the city. And just in case they missed one of the gods, they have an altar to the unknown god. Matter of fact, there's a great legend that goes about this. But the Apostle Paul says, look, here, you have this altar to the unknown god. Let me tell you about this god that you don't know. You'll notice as he uses this, he does not use Scripture. He doesn't say, I'd like for you to turn to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. And there in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, what we see is this, is that in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. But what he does is he shares the message that comes directly from Scripture. He tells them, as you look at his sermon, his talk that he gives, you can take it directly from Scripture. So he tells them what comes from Scripture without necessarily referencing the Scripture, because at this point in time, this audience doesn't recognize the Scripture. That's sometimes we like, well, I've got an atheist friend. What Scripture verse can I share with them? Well, I could probably give you some Scripture verses. Your problem is this, is your atheist friend probably doesn't recognize the Scripture. Now, if you can say, hey, I believe that this is the revelation from God, that I believe that there is a God who is smart and wise and intelligent, who created all things, and is smart and wise enough that is able to reveal himself to us. And I believe that this is his revelation. Would you do me the favor of reading this? God will use that. But if you were to say, ha, I can tell you you're wrong because this passage says, and he goes, so what? I don't believe that. So they don't believe or understand the scripture yet. So he didn't reference the scripture, but he did use cultural references. It's interesting as you look at this, there's two poets, Greek poets, that are used. Aratus and Epitomes there, right? That one reference that he uses there, for even your own poets say, notice there in verse 28, for some of your own poets have said, for we are his offspring. And it's interesting because he didn't necessarily agree with the message the poet said, but there's a truth that the poets had discovered that he could pull out and to say, this truth agrees with Scripture. And so he would use that as a bridge. And then again, notice this, don't shy away from hard truths. Because what hard truth does he bring him to? He brings him to this idea of judgment, that there is a God who will judge all of mankind. Sometimes we like to shy away from that. Like we like to talk about the gospel that, yes, you can be saved today, and if you put your faith and trust and believe in Jesus Christ, you can have eternal life and you can live your blessed life today. And we never talk to people about that. If you do not put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, there is a place called hell that all people who don't trust Christ as Savior will spend eternity there. But because we love and we care for you, there is a way that you don't have to go to hell today. And you can do that by believing in Jesus Christ. Don't shy away from hard truth. You'll notice his outline, and his outline is a great example for us how to share the gospel with a pagan audience. We would call this the creation to Christ approach. We start at creation, establish that there is a God who created all things, that God then judges, governs the world, that God demands holiness and will judge those who are not holy and has provided a way of salvation for those who are not. Notice it begins right with creation. Verse 24, God who made the world and everything in it, we see his sovereign governing of creation there. In verse 26, it has determined their appointed times and boundaries. We see the transcendence of God, that he is not living in temples made with hands, nor is he made with anything there by men's hands. We see God as not only as the governor, but also God as the judge, right? There in verse 30, truly these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands everywhere all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day where he will judge the world in righteousness. And then we also see the way of salvation, because he will judge the world in righteousness by this man, who's the man, Jesus Christ, whom he's proclaimed, given assurance by all, by the raising from the dead. And Paul begins to move into that path where he begins to talk about the redemption that God has provided for all of mankind. He brings up this issue of the resurrection. All of a sudden, they shut him down. We don't want to talk about the resurrection. That's you know, for other people. Notice the Greek audience here did not believe in the resurrection from the dead. And so when they came to this, much of them shut him down there with that. One of the things I have to share, I think, is this. When we talk about the creation to Christ approach, we understand that it's often the slow approach. Meaning, we need to have multiple conversations, right? If you're looking for that one-and-done conversation, I'm going to tell them, I'm going to share the gospel with them, they're going to trust Christ as Savior, never have to talk to them again. That's probably not going to happen with a lot of people who are non-religious or far away from God. What we need to do is we need to develop relationships and to share the gospel multiple times. And we have to begin to build that foundation to where we come to Christ when all of a sudden Christ makes sense. That their eyes are open to see the glorious light of the gospel when you see just how important and significant. You know, Christ as an example, anybody can get that. Christ as a teacher, anybody can get that. But when you say that Christ is the only way of salvation because of his sacrifice and his substitutionary sacrifice, the Holy Spirit's got to bring you to that point. Not everybody agrees or recognizes or understands that point. Thirdly, with this, we work with those who respond to the message. We talk about this being a slow approach, right? Notice what it says there in verse 34. When he came to the resurrection, they kind of shut him down, and you'll notice there's a multitude of responses that were there. When they shut him down, notice what some said. Some, verse 32, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. It should not be a surprise to us, right, when we're sharing the gospel with a non-religious audience that some people will mock and make fun of them. Don't be upset, angry, turned off by it. Don't say, well, I'm never doing that again. This is new to them. This is often not only new, but it's completely foreign to us, right? What has the world been saying to them? Do whatever makes you happy. And all of a sudden you're saying there's a holy and a righteous God who will judge you because you've sinned and violated his righteous standards. That doesn't make me very happy. And so it's completely foreign to them. Don't be surprised by those who mock. Don't be turned off. Notice the second response was polite indifference. Some rejected it, out and out rejected it. They mocked it, made fun of it. Some were very polite, and they said, well, that's very interesting. Perhaps we'll hear from it for another day. Thank you very much, Paul. You can go ahead and go. What are they doing? They're dismissing him without trying to hurt his feelings. And sometimes some people will be very kind and very polite. They don't believe what we're saying. They haven't accepted our message, but they'll give us a polite indifference. Don't reject that, right? Don't, well, you filthy heathen, you're going to go to hell because of this. Don't burn a bridge that you want to come back over, right? That's one of the things that we're going to learn here is this, is right, because we understand that this takes time, we want to establish and build a relationship. Always keep a bridge that you can come back over. If they're willing to say, right, what are they willing to say? Now, they may have just did it out of polite indifference. We'll hear from you another time. Thank you very much. Go away. But they did say, we'll hear from you another time. And so what I heard is, I can come back and have this conversation again. Now, it may be a little while down the road. They're not completely shut off. They're not the mockers who are making fun of it to try and offend you and hurt you. These are polite. And so I want to keep that bridge. I want to leave that door open so I can come back to them. Something else is going to happen in the news. Something else is going to come up. The Easter is going to come around. I want to have this relationship with them that I can begin to share again the hope of the gospel again. The third is those who believed. Some have looked at this and said, well, this wasn't very successful on Paul's part. Apparently, only two or three people believed. We don't know exactly how many. We do know there were two. There was Dionysus and there was Damaris, and there were some who believed with them, an unspecified number. Notice Paul didn't say, well, back in Berea, the whole synagogue believed back in Berea, this is just not worth my time. I think I'm going to go somewhere else. No, he went out with them, and he joined with them, and he continued to disciple and to train them. Work with those who believe. It's not about the numbers. Thessalonica, the majority rejected. Berea, the majority believed. Here in Athens, coming back from a pagan background, it was slow going. We shared this the other day, right? William Carey was there in India for 7 years before he saw his first convert. Why do we think that all of a sudden we're going to have great success overnight? Let's be faithful to communicate that. So let me bring you to this challenge, and we'll close. First challenge is this: who are you developing a relationship with so that you can share the gospel? Sometimes we've challenged people to invite someone to church. I remember we did that. We challenged people to invite somebody to come to church, and we were trying to reach people with the gospel. And they said, well, my granddaughter, she's a really wonderful person. She goes to this church over here. I think she'd be a great addition to our church. That's not who we're trying to reach. We love her. She's a wonderful person. But if she's already involved in a church, who are you developing a relationship to reach the gospel? Maybe it's somebody who is formerly churched, and they've got a church background, or maybe they're not in church right now, and you want to share the gospel with them. Maybe, you've got that person that is an out-and-out pagan. I mean, they're a heathen. And they don't hide it, right? There are some people that are respectable enough that, they know you're religious, and so they pretend to be religious around you. And then you got some people, they are who they are, and they let it all hang out. Honestly, I'd rather prefer those people because they're not putting a fake face on. They're letting you know where they are. And yet, here's the reality. Jesus Christ loves them. Jesus Christ died for them. He wants to rescue them and bring them into a relationship with. Who are we developing a relationship with? And then secondly, who are you praying for and sharing Jesus with who is far away from God? Right? Let's not just go after, so-and-so, they go down to the church down the road. Let's go after them. No, let's pray for them. Let's encourage them. Let's support them. Let's go after the person who doesn't know Christ as Savior. They may be an out-and-out pagan. They may be a great moral person. They just don't know Christ as Savior. Let's be sharing the gospel together with them. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer together. God, we thank you for this great message of hope that you've given to us. Pray, Lord, that you'd be with us now, that you would put a burden in our hearts, that we would not leave here today without a name in our hearts and in our heads that we're praying for. Somebody who maybe is religious but doesn't know Christ as Savior, or somebody who may be an out-and-out heathen, but Lord, they're still loved by you. God, may you burden us today with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We want to give you the opportunity to respond to the gospel today. If you don't know Christ as Savior, we want to share him with you today. Maybe there is somebody that God's put on your heart today. You just want to come to the altar and to pray for that person today. Maybe there's another spiritual decision God's leading you to respond to today. But as God leads you to respond, you respond to do what he wants you to do today. Troy's going to come and lead us in a hymn of invitation today.
In 4:13, turn your eyes upon Jesus.
O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's life for
our musicians to keep playing here this morning. Before we leave is this, I want to challenge you just to spend a few moments in quiet prayer asking God to give you the name of a person who doesn't know Christ as Savior, to lay that person there upon your heart. And I want to challenge you that before you leave today, there's somebody that you're praying for and that you'll be praying for throughout this week, throughout the coming weeks, that you're just going to continue to pray for that person that they'll come to know Jesus Christ as Savior. Let's take a few moments to just ask God to guide us and direct us. Lord, as we come to you together this morning, we would ask that you would put somebody's name, somebody's face in our minds and in our hearts today. That God, that you would help us to have a burden for them. That Lord, as we have experienced the love of Jesus Christ, that we would share the love of Jesus Christ together with them to help them to understand and to know there is a means of salvation, that they do not have to experience the judgment of God. That you have provided that today in the person of Jesus Christ. And God, may we be burdened. May we be concerned about their spiritual condition. May it disturb us and provoke us so that we can't just kind of continue on in life as business as usual. But God, that you would change us first so that we can share the hope of Jesus Christ together with them next. Be with us now. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me just share a couple of quick announcements here together with you before we leave. Thank you for your faithfulness and your giving. As you leave, there's worship boxes both in the back. Giving boxes both in the back of the foyer as well as down here in the hallway down here. We're thankful for your faithfulness there. So just give you a quick reminder there of that. This Saturday is our ladies' missionary. We'll be having a yard sale to support their ministry there. They often give gifts of encouragement. They support missionaries just a blessing there as God leads them. And so it takes funds and resources in order to do that. And so this year we will not be having the auction that we've had in years past. But what they have decided to do this year is they're going to have a yard sale this Saturday, June 26th, 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. So two things that you can do. One is this: if you've got some stuff that you would like to give, their valuable stuff that somebody else would like that you want to get out of your house, down there in the hallway, in the foyer there, they'll be collecting down there. And then secondly, you can come support them. Get some more valuable stuff that you can fill your house back up with. 8 a.m. to 2 p.m., but come support the ladies' missionary this Saturday here with the yard sale. Next week is our Sunday School Promotion Sunday. We have several that are kind of graduating out of the class that they've been in and graduating into the next class. And so we just kind of want to recognize them and to celebrate them there. And so next week, there, if you have one going into fourth or one going into seventh, we would encourage you to come back there next week as we'll remember and celebrate the success of these young people. And then our 4-H fair. When we come to the 4-H fair, we like to do a fair booth outreach. And we did this 2 years ago. And was blessed by the response both of the people here within the church who signed up to serve as well as those who we ministered to. And so we have a need of volunteers. We need people to man the booth all week. It goes from Sunday until Saturday night. Typically, it's about 5 to 10 p.m. I think on Saturday, it's like 5 to 8 p.m. But we have two time slots for every night. Last time we did this, we signed up, and 2.5 hours goes by really quickly. Most people, when they started the first shift, they usually kind of just hung around for the second shift just because it was kind of a fun thing to do and a blessing to be there. But in the back in the foyer, we have a sign-up sheet for volunteers who will staff that booth, be able to engage people, to share with them about the church. We'll have some gospel presentations, some giveaways there, and kind of just to help to promote the church and just to put a face to the church in the community. We want to take Jesus Christ there into the community to go to people who are far away from him and don't know him yet. And this is a great way. I know last year I had a great, I guess it was 2 years ago, great conversation with a gentleman. We sat and talked for 15, 20 minutes about Jesus Christ and what it meant to know Jesus Christ. I regret to say he did not receive Jesus Christ as Savior and walk away from there. But we engaged in a wonderful conversation. And that's what I want to encourage you to do as well. So I would encourage you there in the back. Some have already signed up already, but sign up there in the back, there in the foyer, there together with that. Before you leave, all of our men, we have a gift there for all of our men. And so make sure you don't leave without that. Our blessing today comes there from Romans chapter 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And before I dismiss you, I just remember one more thing that I would be ashamed if I let this go. This past week, we had our vacation Bible school. You saw some of the pictures running ahead of time. We'll try and run some of those pictures again after the service just to show you what was going on. We had a wonderful week. So I just want to take the opportunity to say thank you to all of those who made that possible. We had a great team of volunteers who showed up, served throughout the week in many different capacities. Several of you donated to the cause, whether it was snacks or craft items or different things. We appreciate that. We, I think, had over 36 kids enrolled, 40 kids enrolled. We had over 40 kids enrolled. I think we had a high of 36. I'll give you some of these numbers. We had a high there, the high 30s there for our highest attended night. Made connections with several families. Some of the families we know already attend other churches, and we're grateful to be able to minister and to serve their kids. We made connections with some of the family members of some of our church folks. But some of the best news is this, is we know of over 3 decisions that were made for Jesus Christ, trusting Jesus Christ as Savior. Vacation Bible School is one of our best evangelistic outreaches that we have for sharing the gospel. And so that's what it's all about. 3 people who are now going to heaven who weren't going to heaven before because of your faithfulness. And so we're grateful for that. So hopefully we'll have those slideshow running again after the service, and you can kind of just stick around to watch the slideshow there with that. But with that, may God bless you. Thank you for being here today. You are dismissed today.